cheerful voices answering back. Are a few of you tired, though, even though you're sounding cheerful?
No.
Did you have a good time last night?
Oh, yeah.
My name is Monique Krieber, otherwise known as Michelle's mom in parts. And I'm going to be moderating this panel. It's my great pleasure to introduce to you Mr. William Anderson.
Yeah!
Woo!
Thank you.
And Ms. T-Head Wolf. So for those of you who are familiar with the 100th episode, how many of you would say you're familiar with it?
Oh, yeah.
I thought it was a lot, yes. For those of you who are familiar, then you are also familiar with Tina's lovely cellist styling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tina and William to say a little bit of, about what they've been working on and some things like that, and then we will open the floor to questions. Andrew, where would you like the microphone for questions to be? You'll set it up over there? Okay, so that, we'll have a lineup over there after if you have some questions, and then we'll go from there. So first of all, these two people are extraordinarily busy and successful musicians here in the LA area. And they are working, William of course is working extensively on My Little Pony, but he also has many other projects that he's working on, and maybe you could tell everybody a little bit of highlights of things that you have happening.
Well, My Little Pony and Equestria Girls is a life sentence. in the very best way. I'm so grateful for the show and work. But there's not a lot of time in my life for too much else. But I have been doing some, I've been writing a lot of personal songs, and I'm working on a new Dizzy show that's, should I talk about other shows? Well, I am, and I will. It's called Yo-Kai Watch.
Woo! Oh, okay.
It's from Japan, and the video that they have in Japan has 99 million hits or something. It's a huge
Whoa.
Show.
Oh, yeah. My
it's
God.
It's going to be on in a couple of months, and they've hired me to do all the, they were struggling with the English versions of the songs, and they came to me after a couple other people, and so I produced the singers and kind of pumped the tracks up and had a lot of fun working on it. And they loved what I did, so now I'm doing a whole bunch of songs for Yo-Kai Watch, and that's a lot of fun. I'm still real busy on My Little Pony. I finished the third Equestria Girls movie. I don't know, sometime in the near past. And I have been just relentlessly forward on season 5 of My Little Pony, and I'm in the middle of episode 20 right now.
Oh, wow.
And other than that, I've been busy with other stuff, but I can't remember. And you guys know what I'm doing, and Tina has a lot of fun stuff going on. So, Tina, why don't you?
Hi.
Hey, Tina.
Contacted me, he actually emailed me, and we hadn't known each other before, so he wrote me an email. He said, "Hey, I'm William, do you want to play cello on My Little Pony?" And I said, "Yes."
Just cold emailed her. Somebody said Tina Guo was very good, and I found her website, and I emailed her cold, just to her website like a fan. "Hi, my name is Will, and I'm writing music for My Little Pony. You want to come play?" It was total, not Hollywood.
I had a great time working with Will and getting to know him and becoming friends, and I'm super excited that, you know, we were asked to perform here. We're performing tonight for the opening of Club Luna at 7 o'clock.
Ooh.
I got this necklace yesterday. It was a gift from someone. Thank you. So I play cello for a living. I started playing cello when I was 7 years old. Both my parents are music teachers, and they're Chinese, so you can imagine that. So I played a lot of cello 8 hours a day, but now I'm really grateful for it, and I'm a full-time musician. I live in Los Angeles.
Nice.
And I do a few different things. So I still play classical cello, and I still tour as a soloist with different orchestras. I have a few concerto concerts coming up in the spring, and then my other passion is heavy metal, so I love playing
Woo! Yeah! Yeah!
I just released a metal album next month, actually in August, called, I know it's very, very creative, it's called Cello Metal. I don't know, do you guys know who John Five is?
Woo!
Marilyn Manson, Wes Borland from Limp Bizkit, and so I had a lot of friends, guests appear playing guitar on all these songs. I did covers of Metallica, Iron Maiden, Pantera, like all the classics, and some original music, so I do metal on that side. I was in the circus LA for 2 years, from 2011 to 2013. They did, I don't know if any of you, even heard about it or saw it, but it was called the Michael Jackson The Immortal World Tour. It was an arena tour around the world. And basically after Michael passed away, unfortunately, the Jackson Estates family was like, oh my God, what are we gonna do? We were supposed to do a tour. Like, this is it, it was supposed to be the tour. So we're like, let's partner up with the circus and make a new hybrid show. So the Cirque du Soleil and the Jackson Estate came together and made this big, weird, like, acrobats and contortionists and Michael's original band from the Bad Era. They put together the whole original band, added a random electric cello player for whatever reason. And so that was a lot of fun. And then in LA, so getting to movies and TV and video game scoring and playing. So I'm trying to think, like, I've worked on some different projects. For movies, I was a soloist on Inception, Sherlock Holmes, Iron Man 2. CSI New York, lots of random TV shows, and for video games, I don't know if it's okay to talk about it yet, but I did play the electric cello solos on Call of Duty Black Ops 2, and there's a new one coming out soon. I'm also going to be at the next BlizzCon if anyone's going to that. Doing a panel for StarCraft, so Diablo. Anyway, it's just stuff. Okay.
Wow. What about Hans Zimmer and Superman versus?
Sure. We're currently working on Batman versus Superman.
I'm sorry.
I mean, it's okay. Sorry.
As I said, very accomplished, and I love all the variety in there. That I learned some things from that I hadn't heard before, too. Oh. Yes, that's fantastic. We should get you, we're doing some songs of Michael Jackson tonight Black Griffin and Michelle's set, so we should get Tina to come and play some
nice.
Stuff. Yeah. Anyway, let's see. So, William. My Little Pony, which is why most of the people are here to see you guys today. I know the question that a lot of people ask is how you came to be involved with the show. That's kind of a common question that comes up a lot, and I'm sure there's people in this audience who don't know your story for that. So how about a little bit of background?
Okay, I have done animation for most of my career for over 20 years, and so I have. A name for scoring animation. And when My Little Pony was being reimagined with Lauren and Hasbro up at DHX in Vancouver, and the hub was around, they tested, it was a small invitation of composers, and it was what's called a blind listening test. They gave us all a minute and a half to score, and it wasn't an open invitation. They invited like eight people, and we all scored, and then they listened to what's called blind, and that means they didn't know who the composer was that they were listening to, and they chose mine, and that's how I got the gig. That's also how Daniel got the songwriting gig. I also tested that, I did a song as well. Daniel did songs and underscore, but they loved, and I loved Daniel's songs too, and I forget the first one he wrote. It was a... It was for Pinkie Pie. I don't think it was a smile song on the test, but I can't pull it up just because I sometimes get stage shy, but it was great, and so that's how I got the show.
Nice.
And we started scoring them like little movies, I you can use library, but we just started. We took an orchestral scoring approach, and we still score every single episode. I spend 2.5 hours as soon as I get the cut, just making detailed spotting notes of everything that I think is right, and I go over it with Jason or the director that's working with him, and then we score it and move on, and we still, you know, we don't use much library unless it's just absolutely perfect. And in fact, in this show, we are Jason temped in. I don't get a lot of temp music. Temp music is when, oh God.
Maybe you can explain to them what library means.
You know, if you've done two or three seasons of an animated show, often they catalog everything you've written, and they just, a music editor will cut it in, and you don't have to do any more original score. And usually because, you know, the characters don't change show to show, and the situations are largely the same, and the story editing and writing overview, you know, they have an arc and a template they work off. So often, you know, the score will work. Music editing.
Recycling.
Yeah, recycling, but we don't do that. We score them all.
Wow.
It's fun. Mm. It's a lot of work.
And Tina already explained how she became involved with the show. But did you already know about My Little Pony and the popularity of the show when you received the email from William?
Well, of course, I think everybody knows My Little Pony. So I knew about My Little Pony, but I hadn't heard of the show. I mean, I knew it was popular, but to me it was almost something like, I don't know, like Coca-Cola or the Beatles, like, you know, popular culture. So, you know, everybody knows about it, but it's been really fun to, I only played on one song, like, you know, I didn't really do that much, but, like, the fans and the people who are into the show were so warm and awesome and nice, and people, I remember sort of, like, tweeting and stuff, and I was like, oh, cool. So, yeah, it's been a really, really cool, eye-opening experience to be kind of drawn into this world.
When Tina says she didn't play that much, if you've heard the track where she plays, I don't think a lot of people can play it like that. Her technique and ability is pretty astounding.
Oh.
She'll pay you later.
It's really liberating as a composer too, because I listened to, after she said, yeah, I'll play, and then I listened to a bunch of her stuff actually before, and I go, good Lord, I can write anything that I want. It really frees you as a composer.
Awesome. And William, when did you become aware of the fact that a fandom was building up for the show? Everybody involved with the show usually has a moment when they go, oh, this is going to be something different than what I expected going into it.
It wasn't for a long time because I live in my cave. Everybody was saying, you know, the show's doing really well. We're getting, but it was in season two or towards the end of season two, and the show was a big hit. And really didn't. I went to the Evergreen Brony, the conference in Seattle.
That's Northwest. That's where
yeah.
we met.
Yeah, right. And that was when I was astonished when I got into the
2012.
Hotel and I was just surrounded.
Yeah.
And it took 45 minutes to get to my room.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, it was astonishing. I had no idea.
So if you have questions, why don't we have you start lining up over here? And I think Andrew's going to supply us with a microphone. Or is there one there already? Oh, that's right. I see that. Yeah, we'll have the lineup go on this side.
Not right now.
And, why don't we have the first person proceed right now? Sure, go ahead. What's that? Any, okay, here, you can ask anything that you want that's appropriate. And
that's appropriate.
To do with things that have not been aired yet. They can't answer anything that is still confidential.
Grab the microphone and fire away.
You go ahead there, but it'll be easier if we don't have room. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead with your question.
I think it's a wireless mic. Just pull it out of there,
there,
hold the mic, yeah. Turn it on.
There.
Now sing.
What am I supposed to sing?
Yes, sing your question.
I requested. Who is the best singer in My Little Pony?
Well, that's a better question for Daniel, but don't the vocals sound great on every single song?
Yeah,
I'm kidding. I mean, that's really my answer.
Sorry.
Thank you very much. I love it. Can I have you take the whole microphone stand and just walk a little bit that way, just so you guys don't have to walk so far to get to it? Just not right in front of the speaker. Or
that's probably good, right?
It's right there. It'd be perfect. Thank you so much.
All right, I got a question for you.
Me?
Yes.
You. Yes.
So, you said you played soundtracks for Call of Duty Black Ops 2, right?
Yes.
Okay. Did you ever get to meet a person named David Von Hard? If you did, did you think he was a nice person?
I've never met David. I hope he's a nice person.
I mean, he did something with the game that got everyone like really mad. So
what? What did he do?
Well, you see, there's a community for the game called the sniping community.
Yeah.
Yeah, and people basically make YouTube videos about it, so they can make a living off it, basically. Well, what he did is that he slowed down the fire rate, basically to make the sniper shoot slower.
Okay.
So that made a lot of people angry. He got a lot of hate for it.
That's weird. Yeah. No, I don't know him, but if I ever meet him, I'll slap him for you.
You have to realize in a show or a game or any kind of project like that, there are so many different divisions of people that work on it, and only in the situation like this, where this show became really popular, have we had the opportunity to meet the composers, or meet the writers, or meet the animators, even a lot of the management team. It normally doesn't happen, at least not for the voice actor side. It normally doesn't happen that people cross over this much, and it's been wonderful that we get to meet everybody, even in different cities. But normally, in those kinds of projects, you only work with the people that are in your exact department, and you often never meet the people on the other sides of things. Yeah.
Thank
you very much.
So this is a two-pronged question for Will. How different was it doing a dubstep track? And as a composer for a show, are you forced to do a lot of different genres that you might not be familiar with?
I always say that animation composing is one of the toughest gigs in the business. We have to write all styles, and you have to do a lot of music in a short amount of time. And so it's a relentless, hard work week. You know, it takes 50 to 60 hours to score the show, right? And we just get a week of show. And the dubstep thing, Jason and I dreamed it up. I had written some electronic, more like progressive house stuff for DJ Pons in his earlier incarnation. And I guess it became popular out on the internet, and Jason said, you know what, Will, you almost made this guy, you know? He was just supposed to be 3 seconds, and so they decided in show 100 to really give him something big, and he just said, why don't you just go write a dubstep piece, like a 3-4 minute instrumental, and we'll cut the picture to it and make it like a little music video. And I don't remember, oh no, and of course, yeah, Octavia is going to be in it, so let's do it with cello. And so that's how it happened. It was just like that. And I started writing something, and I sent him like a kind of a sketch, you know, I sketched in some synth cello parts and a groove and an arrangement, and they loved it immediately and just said, okay, go for it. And that's what happened.
Thank you.
Good question.
We'll do it the old-fashioned way. Yeah, I'm sure you're all very familiar with Carl Stone Project and Bugs Bunny on Broadway. Do you think that a full live mini orchestra thing like Bugs Bunny on Broadway would be doable with My Little Pony, and who do we have to blackmail to make it happen?
I think it would be a great thing to do.
Sure.
And and of course, I have very little influence to get that done. But yeah, wouldn't that be fun? I mean, that's kind of what Tina and I are doing tonight. We're going to run the film from the dubstep thing while we play.
Yeah, excellent. It'll be the scenes of it. All right, thank you much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew.
Oh, yeah, the lunch. First of all, I just want to say,
broke it. Yeah, treated.
Those things suck batteries.
Check, check.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank everybody out there for your contribution to the show. Really, really loved it. And also, Tina, I want to thank you, my girlfriend, studying for executive MBA, and it's brutal, and she needs to see your music to get through it. Absolutely. My question is for you, though. I wanted to find out, and I don't know if you've done any collaboration or if you've thought about it, with those two Croatian cellos, two cellos.
Yeah, they're awesome.
Yeah, have you ever thought of maybe doing something with them?
Yeah, I would love to. I mean, doing collaborations with people is kind of, it's not complicated, but, you know, a lot of times it has to do with, like, the labels or, like, you know, a lot of the brands and management. So I haven't met them personally, because if you're, like, personally friends with someone, like, you know, the other people I play with, then you can just say, hey, let's do something together, and it's, you know, but... We'll see. Maybe one day. Yay, child power.
Thank you.
Advice for college students entering a music major.
What kind of music major?
Exactly. Like a performance or composition or
classical,
like composition and story.
Okay. Well, learn from everybody you're studying with. Actually, and then just go hustle work. I know a lot of people say try to get any job you can, and even after you do it for free, that's okay. I feel that's not good for the community, and so I don't, even if I have somebody working for me to do something and I'm not getting paid, I pay them, and I have since I had very little, and I always will do that. But it's really, for me, the degree never did much to advance my career. It was all hustle, finding work, making it happen, making sure they liked me, never having an attitude, getting it done by when they said, doing my best work always, staying in touch with them. I've never had an agent. I've been self-represented my whole career, and it's just being grateful and doing your best work and staying in touch. Mm-hmm. Education is so important. If somebody works for me, I'd like for them to have a composition degree. You know what I mean?
I mean, I went to USC and I actually dropped out of school, speaking of degrees, not necessarily, you know, but so I went to school for cello performance, but then I started actually getting really busy and performing, so then I left school. But I think, you know, going into music major, we talked about this a little bit earlier, music, just like anything else we do, it's, you know, it's difficult. There's a lot of people, it's very competitive, and definitely what Will said about just being, first of all, being nice, you know, like I think, ego is probably the worst thing anyone can have in anything. Maybe a little bit, you know, is okay, but just being a really nice person, staying humble, trying to work, like for me at least, you know, try to do the best that you can and always deliver more than you promise, you know? So just, I don't know, work hard, be nice to people.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good
stuff.
When you were writing the background scores for the episodes, do you delve more into the psyche of the ponies that the scene is playing out with, or the interactions and the events that's happening in the episode? Which one plays into it more?
Both of those things play, and that's a good question. Like I said, I spend over 2 hours before I write a note on each episode, and there's different facets of the score. Like, there's what I call the linear psychological point of view, getting the gestures, hitting the emotional beats and reactions, and that's like when they're just talking and or walking and it's exposition, that's like the hardest thing to do. And you, because you want to tell the story, you want to be character specific without being too on the nose. This is not an on the nose Bugs Bunny type of cartoon. It's important to capture the big emotions that are most relevant to the story. And then there's the parts of the show often that are, there's big set pieces, whether it's the end of a climactic two-parter or a crazy race through a neighborhood. And you know, the set pieces are treated more like big Hollywood epic scores. And those are nice because they're defined and you just go after them until you get them right. They're big, they're hard, they take a long time. It's the elusive, because the good underscore for the character is an exposition and catching the gestures and which reactions to mark, and you want to do it in a way that's invisible, that draws too much attention to itself and you're listening to the score. That's not the job. It wants to be invisible. And that to me is the trickiest part of really any score. And I call it the linear, psychological point of view, character, gesture, and story, tell the story part.
Well, I know the music, since I'm musically inclined, definitely keeps my attention during the episode, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, can we get a little more of the mic from the monitor, a little bit of the question mic up here?
That'd be awesome.
Here.
Thank you.
Yay, it's short enough for me.
I still can't hear her.
I said, yay, it's short enough for me. Short question and then a regular length question. Short one, you said that you were working on like the 20th episode a couple weeks ago. How close to the airing date are you working on the episodes?
I'm close. You know, Monique and Michelle and Daniel are what they call pre-production, because the songs have to ship with the dialogue record, which is then slugged to time and animated. In post-production, the effects, the ADR, and the score, they used to call it a post-score. I get a locked print that's exactly what you see on air, I finish it and it's on the air in about 2 or 3 weeks.
Wow. Whereas, as you were saying, we're like the bookends. The script is written, the actors then record the script and we record the songs, and Daniel writes the songs, of course, we record the songs and then it goes to animation, which is a very long process, and goes for scoring at the very end. So for us, the things that we do don't air for usually at least a year after we do them. And you'll often find when you ask people questions in any part of the process what they did on this episode, that they look like they can't remember, and it's because you can't, because there's
so 20 episodes ago.
Yeah. Exactly.
It's funny, in the studio, like when I go up to DHX, or really anything, I mean, on any of the other shows, it's always funny for me, in pre-production, when they're recording all the scripts, you go into and on drafting boards, and it's just teeming with life. When I come to do my job, it's a ghost town. I go into the studio, and the room is gutted and empty. There's 4 executive producers left, and everybody's left the building. It's post.
Thank you very much. Oh, for a second. Is it okay if I have a second one?
Go ahead.
Okay. My boyfriend is a composer as well, and he's recently started getting his foot into the business, and he's working on a proposition with commissioned for a proposition by Nintendo. We're really excited about it and hoping it works, and he's trying to figure out, like, he loves to compose, and he loves scoring and everything, but at the same time, he also wants to, like, keep his inner artist happy. Like, do the things that make him happy. How do you do both, like being a professional composer and keeping your inner artist happy?
I've always been so grateful just to work that I've never had that distinction. A friend of mine, when I used to play like in, you know, like a punk new wave band back in the day. And when I started getting jobs scoring commercials and stuff, we didn't never made any money, and he was all like, you know, I couldn't do that, it would affect, you know, my, because of the artist, and we, you know, and I was like, God, Joe's pizza truck needs a jingle, and it's $50. I don't know, it sounds better than working at Vaughn's, you know? So I've never had that. I've always been so grateful to be able to write music for a living. And I also feel, like I look at commercial artists that come to their own voice later in life because they've had the time to refine their craft over and over. Jerry Goldsmith and John Williams in the golden ages of television had offices on the Universal lot writing for all like all those, you know, Wild Wild West and all those shows, and they wrote. Ken Follett wrote many novels as just page-turner thrillers before he did Pillars of the Earth, which is just a masterpiece of literature. And he came to get that craft because, you know, he wrote thousands of, you know, many other books. So I think commercial art is a great way to pay your bills while you refine and find your own voice.
That's a really good way to look at it.
Yeah.
Music is music. All art is art. I might be a little bit biased because my ex-boyfriend actually was we had a band together. I'm not gonna say his name, so I'm not, you know, bad mouthing anyone in public. But he was a, you know, aspiring artist for basically his entire life, and he refused to get a job because he refused to make any money because he said, no, I'm an artist. I don't want to do anything except for my own music. Of course, I broke up with him, but.
But
like for me also, anything that I work on, whether it's My Little Pony or my classical music or metal or playing on like a pop artist track or touring with, you know, Alicia Keys, with it, like it doesn't matter. It's all, in the end, it is all music. And, you know, yeah, I definitely feel lucky for any opportunity I get to play my instrument or do anything that's even music related, you know, so.
And also, he's a really big fan of yours, Tina, so he wants to say hi.
Oh, hi.
Thank you very much.
I think William invited a couple of people to crash the panel, and he may have made a mistake by doing that, but I think they're here, so I'm wondering if they would like to come on.
Oh my gosh, come on.
And Michelle Freeman.
Hello. Uh-oh, my mic's on. That's the first mistake they made.
So for those of you, I'm pretty sure a lot of you are in the know, Michelle is the voice of Apple Bloom and the singing voice of Sweetie Belle for most of Sweetie Belle's songs. And so as such, and she's also the singer for Apple Bloom, so she has sung on many songs from the show over the years. And Black Griffin was recently singing, he did some vocals on the first episode of this season. He's also on the latest CD that just came out. And in fact, they're both on the latest CD that just came out. What is that CD called again?
Songs of Harmony, I think.
Is that
and
it?
I think Rebecca did the Winter Soul Wrap Up and True True Friend mashup song, which was really fun. And then, what song did you?
I don't know.
Is it Hearts as Strong as Horses on that? You know what, we should
know. I love your answer, Michelle. I always get, you know, on episode 13, in the second season, were you referencing Jerry Goldsmith's Gremlins score? And I just go blank.
What do you think?
Well, yeah.
We should know the answers to this. In fact, the first CD that came out, Michelle was on, or maybe it was the second one, she was on several songs, and we didn't even know she was on it until a fan actually sent a link to it on iTunes, and then I looked at it like, oh my goodness, she's on three or four songs on the CD, and then after that, then we got some paperwork to do with the CD. So it's funny, like a lot of times, the Equestria Girls was the same thing. We actually didn't know Michelle was in the Equestria Girls movie. She recorded the lines for it a year before, and we didn't realize, it wasn't actually going to be a feature film at first, I don't think. We didn't realize, and then somebody said, well, if you're not, they asked her if she was in the movie, and she said no, and they said, well, then who's voicing Apple Bloom? So we looked at it on IMDb and went, oh, yes, she is in that. And then I looked at the contract and went, oh, yeah, she did do a session on that. So that's what we mean by it's hard to keep track of things that you've done.
Jason and I always wanted it to be a feature. And when it was first coming out, first he told me, you know, they're all going to be teenagers and human. And we were all looking at each other like, oh my God, you know. Because the show had become so successful, and I was like, is this going to kill us all? But then we got on board with the idea, and when we sat down and talked about the music, I go, Jason, let's just score it like it's an animated feature. Let's score it like we're Pixar or Disney or whatever. And then by the time we were done with it, they released it as a feature. So, and, you know, it was fun.
Yeah, it was a nice bonus. Anyway, sorry for the long delay for the next question. Come on up. Thank you.
Hello? Okay, this is a question for Will. It's kind of two questions. The first question is, how much of your scoring in the show is MIDI and how much of it is real instruments?
It's almost all MIDI. It's predominantly I use the East West Symphonic Orchestra library, top to bottom, from picks to double bass. But I use the Vienna woodwinds because they have more point and less room. And then it's just a whole grab bag of whatever I need, you know, because there are little different styles, but all the same stuff, the native instruments, plugins, Symphobia or Omnisphere or Stylus or Battery or Addictive Drums and Trillion, you know.
I have to ask you to write that down for me so I can look at it.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
Oh, no, it's okay. The second question is, what makes you decide when to use a real instrument and what made you decide to use a real cello for the 100th episode?
It's rare that I have time, you know, because we do a show a week. But when it comes, you know, it's always, you know, I can have I think they call it a blend score, you know, when you have a couple of live players come in. And I do that anytime I can because I love having real players. But then also as time permits and the situation merits. There was just a show a couple of weeks ago where there was a montage with Applejack doing some things. And I wanted real banjo in it to elevate it. So I got my buddy Jim West, who's in Weird Al's band. They're on tour. You know, I will actually plug my buddy Al and all the guys in the band. I recorded and toured with Al way back in the day, and he still is triumphant, and his tour is selling out everywhere, and they're getting great reviews. But Chemo's on the bus, and I just emailed him and said, can you... well, I told him, do you still have your $100 banjo with you? And he said, yeah, and he plays, you know, I sent him the track, and he knocked out some banjo in his hotel room, and he mailed it back, and popped it right in the show. You know, it took him an hour to do it, and when it's like that, it's very convenient.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And, I was just going to say, Andrew, are we okay to go a little bit over since we got started later, or do you want to end? We're okay? Okay. We'll go a little longer then, but we would like to try to get through as many questions as possible so we can...
Hey, Danny. You look if I move over a little bit and kind of lean over towards your...
So, I mean,
I just appreciate talent.
I guess for
everyone.
Probably Michael Jackson. I really like Michael Jackson.
Cinderella's.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello.
So this question, I'm interested to see if there's a lot of uniformity or variation in your answers. And the question is, where do you draw your music inspiration from, and what does your process look like from start to finish?
Deadlines. It has to get on air, you have to finish. And sometimes you have to send your children out in the world before they are ready. And you have to sketch fast and make a lot of paintings. And not all of them are going to be perfect, but you try to get better over time. My process is to get all the most important beats done right It's tough, you know. Television animation, you have to sketch fast and make a lot of paintings. Did I answer your question?
Thank you.
Yeah, deadlines, I'm serious. I'll fiddle around with the queue for the rest of my life unless I have a deadline.
Were you asking that question for everybody?
Yes, is that all right?
Yeah, sure.
Inspiration varies, I guess, depending on the song. I think, actually, Nathaniel and I kind of like the electronic music sound because he's always had electronic keyboards and stuff way back in the day before he was sequencing, just playing stuff. And our music, a lot of people say our music sounds a lot like Owl City. We were writing stuff like that before Owl City came out.
Yeah.
But, I mean, well, we do love Owl City, but we're not copying this kind of, but I draw some inspiration from Michael Jackson.
I love Michael Jackson.
But it depends on what I'm, the mood that I'm in. If I hear something really inspiring, then I'll try to write a song that's similar to that, or if I see something inspiring, I'll write a song based off of what I saw.
Our process, it also varies. We just wrote a song and, 2 days, it happened so fast with Nathaniel.
That's because we had a deadline.
Yeah, exactly, the deadline. We wanted to have a new song performed tonight, so we just kind of pooped it out and didn't overthink it.
That's the official term.
That's the most eloquent way of putting it.
This is the new track that we pooped out.
11 o'clock tonight, be there and you will see the
pooped out.
Well, everybody's already talked about the deadline thing, which of course, But I think for me, music is art, it's expression, just like any kind of art, actually anything in the world, if you're a business person, if you're, all of it is just expression. So for me, my inspiration comes from feelings. I know it sounds super cheesy, feelings, but it's true, So if you feel, for me, maybe feeling weird or, I don't know, dorky, because, when I was super, with my big cello walking around like a turtle, or a geek or whatnot, but relationships, boyfriends, falling in love, having fights, breaking up, stuff like that. So it's all, for me, all the inspiration comes from being a human being.
That's a fantastic answer.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Forced to be very prolific. What do you do to just sit down and knock out what you need to get knocked out?
Yeah, I don't put it on the page for this kind of job. I always have the picture in the dialogue running because my art is to serve that and tell the story. And I've tried to find the first thought that brings it alive or does what needs to create the sense of mystery or adventure or excitement or tension that it needs. I find whether it's a tempo or a percussion, or just some kind of sound that sounds cool and brings it alive. And I find that and I sketch it out for the minute or whatever the scene is, and then I just fill it in. Starting with what I think is most important, and sometimes I fill it in too much, I color it in too much, and it gets too big, and I start experimenting with dropping some of the instruments out and making it so that it's just more clear and economical. I strive to just be essential and not overproduce the cue. It just needs to be what it needs to be. It's important not to just flex your muscles every time, It has a job to do. Just try to keep it there. But yeah, I find it, and then I color it in. And then I print it, I mix it as I'm writing, and then I just move relentlessly forward.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
This question is mostly for Tina, but the rest of you have answers for it too. Go for it. Oh, it's two questions.
Well, we'll power through, so we'll
do this one. What's your favorite metal band, and what's your favorite concerto?
Okay, I like old school Metallica.
Woo!
Yeah!
Already 20 million times, but they're not really, are they metal? I don't know, they're more industrial, so I love Rammstein. Favorite concerto, maybe the Elgar concerto, because it's very depressing but beautiful.
Thank you very much.
also have a question for Tina. What keeps you motivated to do the work that you do in life?
What keeps me motivated? Honestly, my parents, who were crazy tiger dragon parents, truly, because I've analyzed myself, I'm like, why am I such a workaholic? Why can I not relax? Which is actually a problem, and I'm trying to work on that myself. But they've instilled into my brain. I just always hear them saying to me, it's in Chinese, so what would the equivalent be? Don't waste time, be productive, what did you do today, you know? So, of course, too much of that is unhealthy, I know, but, so part of it, a lot of it, I think I can attribute to my parents just, like, drilling into my head, which made for a very miserable childhood. However, I am very, very, very grateful for it now, truly, because a lot of times, you know, anything worth doing, anything to do really well, you have to sacrifice something, so my sacrifice was my childhood, but that's okay. I really love creating, you know, music, pictures, videos. I do a lot of music videos once a month. And for me, it's just about, you know, creating stuff and having fun. And I'm, you know, lucky to be able to do that. So,
yeah, I get it. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Before I ask my question, I wanted to make a comment and say thanks to Will and Tina for being so nice to me and my mom yesterday at lunch.
Oh,
so a question for Tina. How long have you been playing your cello for?
Well, I'm turning 30 in 2 months, and I started cello when I was 7, so 20,
oh, wow.
Almost 23 years.
Wow.
Yeah. Thank you.
I love your cosplay. Yeah.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Yep.
My name is Christopher, and I wanted to ask, hey, what was it like working on all those other CDs like you were talking about earlier? I own, like, I think all of those CDs that have been released recently on the show's music, by the way, were really good work.
I didn't write any of that. No, I'm kidding. I mean, I'm not kidding. Aren't we talking about Daniel's songs?
I'm just saying Daniel and yours, both you guys are both, I wish Daniel was here too this time.
I think it's great that they're putting this stuff out on record. And if there's a petition to release some of the scores, and I know that people would like to see it, and I'm all for that too. It'd be really fun to, like, let the fans pick out their, whatever, 15 favorite scenes from everything we've done, and then remaster all those cues and put them out on a record. So, yeah, thank you. That's great.
Oh, and I wanted to thank, I never got a chance to since the Tweeted video came out. Thank you, Michelle and Ms. Money, for everything during the panel at the 2013. I was in on the video scenes.
Thank you. I remember you from there. And yes, that was the last time that we did a convention here in LA, and a lot of you did participate, and I know it was a late night, but thank you for doing that. And then Black Griffin was still in Japan at that time, but he still participated greatly. He helped write the song and produce it. But the video was really popular.
That stage, he felt like
remember when
he
did that.
Stage. I have to remember how many people were called on that stage when we did, you know, when we were singing. That was crazy.
It was
late
warm.
Night, right.
Yeah, thank you very much for participating.
I think that's the song that cut out because my battery was going dead on one of my recording devices.
Nice stuff.
Hello? Hi there. My question for Gina, I wanted to ask you, you said that you were growing up, you know, with, you know, your parents thinking you want to play the cello. So when was the point for you that you decided that heavy metal was a part of your life?
Sorry, I'm kind of like this because I actually improved your hearing. Did you know that? That's why I just
started to hear. Sorry. Sorry, can you
hear me? Sorry. What did you say?
When was are still hard to hear out here.
When was the point in your life that heavy metal and all that kind of music became a big piece?
Okay, so I've always, you know, growing up, we weren't allowed to listen to anything but classical music, because again, my parents were classical musicians also. So I only managed to sneak in two CDs, or actually they were tapes, so two cassette tapes, into our home before I was 18, before I went to college. One was Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction. Woo! Woo! My best friend, her name is also Tina, so Tina, she like, snuck her, she's like, here, check this out. And then, I was in 6th grade, and there's this guy that I had a crush on. He was like a goth guy, rabbit with really, I remember, like, big glasses, like really thick, like Coke bottle glasses, and his name was Luke. And he gave me, he let me borrow his Marilyn Manson Antichrist Superstar album. So, but that was really like my only exposure to harder, heavier music, aside from classical and, you know, random radio stuff. So I really loved it. I think for me it was more of just like my parents said, oh, you can't listen to that, that's evil, that's bad, you know, don't do that. And I, of course, you want to do what you can do, so. When I went to college, that's when I started experimenting. I got an electric cello and I started really listening and exploring other genres of music. I went to, you know, the Hollywood strip and went to different clubs to listen to local bands and stuff, so that's how it happened.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Cutting the questions there, is that correct? Okay, so thank you very much. Sorry if we didn't have a chance to get to everybody. William and Tina will be performing their song from the 100th episode tonight at 7 p.m. to kick off the Lunar...
It's 3 minutes long, so don't be late.
Yeah, do not be late, it is only 3 minutes long. And then at 11 o'clock, Michelle and Black Griffin take the stage with Basic. The three of them will be performing hits from their immortal, new songs that they've written on the upcoming CD, and Timeless and all sorts, and the Jackson stuff, the Jackson tribute stuff, so.
Yeah, actually, if anyone wants to, I don't know if Will, of course, you can do, but we have I'm doing a meet and greet at 12:30.
Okay.
And maybe he doesn't want to
come. No,
if you have more questions, you can hang out with us.
Yeah, I'll come hang out.
Yeah, 12:30 to 1:30, and then we're doing autographs from 1:45 to 3:15.
Yay! I know some people didn't get to ask their questions. If it was for me or you know, I'll hang out front after the panel, and I'm free to address any lingering issues that anyone may have.
So thank you.